We will hear now from Christian Vitry. Dr. Vitry is a professor and researcher at the National University of Salta, Argentina, an instructor in the Mountain Guides Association, a real adventurer, and it's the director of the Qhapaq Program Andean Road System for UNESCO in the province of Salta, Universidad Nacional de Salta, Argentina. Dr. Vitry's topic is Inca religious power, high mountain worship, and pilgrimages. Dr. Vitry.
Muchas gracias. Buenos días a todos.
Thank you. Good morning. First of all, I would like to thank Ramiro Matos, my colleague, as well as Jose Barreiro, and through them, the whole team that has worked really hard to make this exhibit possible, this symposium, and also to create this very important space for our beloved Andean world. The issue that I will be addressing in my presentation is the following. Actually, the title is a little bit of fiction, because I'm not going to talk too much about high mountain worship or pilgrimages. I'm going to talk about archaeological objects and spaces, sites that will help us learn about mountain worship and pilgrimages that take place in those areas. Mountains as sacred objects or elements is a universal phenomenon. In many places, mountains are sacred, and where there are no mountains, there are pyramids. It might not be a coincidence. In other words, we need those elements that connect ourselves to verticality, to celestial sites, places. But one might wonder, why? Why are these mountains sacred? Well, there are different interpretations. These are the most generic and universal ones. For example, there is a rupture in terms of the horizon and a projection towards the sky. These places are not very accessible, and therefore they're full of mystery, such as the sea, for example. Especially the sea was a very mystic place until someone actually took a boat and crossed the big ocean. Same thing with caves. If they're not, places that are not accessible are mysterious and therefore are charged with a religious nature. Mountains are also sponges. They're big water reservoirs. They're are always linked to fertility because of this. In fact, the highest mountain in the planet, Everest Mountain, whose indigenous name is Komoluma, which means mother goddess of fertility. Therefore, we can see that all the rivers and all the water that humans and life in general need stem from the mountains. In the Andean region, as well as in many other places in the world, mountains are where ancestors live. In the Andean world, we have the Pacarina and Pacarisa, the origin of ancestors. We have the places where spirits come from. And when people die, in the Andean beliefs, they go back to the mountain. Then we have the sapos, the deities of the mountain. And finally, another element that must not be forgiven is their beauty, pure and simple beauty. These places are extremely beautiful and therefore need to be worshipped, or can be worshipped. Mountains have stories, have lives. The Andean landscape is charged with life. The Andean landscape is alive and is the landscape that has to be worshipped. And in the past, there were sacrifices done to the mountain. And here I have a story that I would like to share with you. Illimani is a mountain that you see on the slide. You can see it's one of the highest ones in Bolivia, and you can see it from La Paz. And there's a story that says that there was a conflict between that mountain and the Mururata because they were two apus, two deities, and there couldn't be two. Therefore, there was a confrontation. And finally, Illimani threw a stone and blew a head off that ended up in the highlands. And another deity was created, the Sahana, the one at the bottom. Therefore, these stories are full of life. Mountains have sex, actually, have gender. They're masculine, they're feminine, they have personality, they have character, they have stories. There's a whole narration around them. We need to go beyond our knowledge. We can't just stay with just one field, archaeology or natural history. We have to think outside the box, go beyond, be invaded by those landscapes, because otherwise we are compartmentalizing everything in silos and missing half of the story. In the Andean region, mountains are worship places. And this is one of the places, the Andean region, where this type of worship became very important. In fact, during the Inca era, more than 200 mountains were worshipped, most of them located south from Cusco. Probably this is related to the Aymaras, who worshipped mountains. Within these mountains, there are 15 where human sacrifices were recovered, and one of them is the highest one with the highest archaeological site in the planet, which is the Yuyayaco volcano. We see some of the mummies that were offered and sacrificed in a ceremony called Acapacocha. These are children, very young children, and each one of them has a story. And that's what we wanted to talk about right now. We wanted to analyze those stories of these people, these children that were sacrificed. Now, the space is telling us something else. Here we have a list of these mountains where we saw human sacrifices. If we see the chart, we'll see that the height of the mountain is one figure, but the sacrifice takes place farther down. Very few times it happens at the summit. The way this is interpreted is that the highest place is where the priest would stand because it's the most sacred place, and that's where the priest would connect with Mother Nature, with the Pachamama. And therefore, these children that were going to become deities had to stand a little lower. Humanity was a little lower from that deity, the summit of the mountain. Therefore, the summits were the susmus, the place where the priest would stand and direct the ceremony, the worship, the sacrifice, the offering. The Qhapaqnyan reaches these places during the Inca conquest. That was not only the surface level. There was also a verticality. Some of the trails are very high. These ceremonial trails connect the lower lands with celestial sphere. One of the most studied ones is the Yuyayaco. One of the mountains that I studied the most is the Yuyayaco volcano. It's almost 6,000 meters high, and we see these trails in the Qhapaqnyan. They have different characteristics. We have walls on either side of the trail. Even in the summit of the Yuyayaco, we have these trails. They reach all the way to the summit, and they reach the platform from which these three children were sacrificed 500 years ago. And from here, we can move on to other things that will help us understand the importance of these sacred places. In this case, I am talking about an archaeological finding that we found in 2011. We found shoes that up until now, we were wondering, actually, how do Incas do to go up to 5,000 or 6,000 meters high? We only knew there were some ceremonial moccasins and sandals, but we didn't know of any other type of shoes. There were no trekking shoes, double, triple hiking shoes that we have right now to climb shoes, and human beings were human beings, you know. The weather was really cold, and the weather conditions were there. The very challenging weather conditions. This finding happened just by chance, almost. This is the Yuyayaco volcano, and this is our archaeological site. And then 80 meters away from the site, inside a hole in a rock, we found just a lump, basically, something wrapped in wool. We took it, and in the Mountain Archaeological Museum, we started analyzing this thing that we found, and we found five shoes. So these were the shoes used by the Incas to climb to the summits of the mountains. And this was a very pleasing surprise, because these shoes were not only prepared to cold weather, but they also had other elements. For example, they had seams, stitches. The structural stitches were done with human hair fibers. This is an excellent type of fiber, actually. We found this type of fiber when funeral artifacts were sewn. Human fibers were used. Therefore, these shoes were made with human hair. But that's not the only thing we found, actually. Look at this. In this case, we have a sandal worn by one of the kids. The base, the sole, is vegetal fiber, and the upper is also made with human hair. Therefore, this human hair means something. It's part of the offering. Another element that we found in these shoes are the knots. Knots that do not have any practical function. They don't help attach anything or make it tighter. It's just basically for decoration. But we can't just think about knots only as decoration, because we know that they use knots for communication purposes. The quipus also have information in the knots. Therefore, they are part of a code that is not known to us, but we are aware of it. Finally, another element, and maybe the most important one, is the thread called yoke, or twisted towards the left, which shows contrast, and this shows duality, black and white, good and evil, life and death, and the return, since it's twisted towards the left, it's the return, and this type of thread is still used in the Pachamama festivities. Their bracelets are made of these threads, and they're used to protect them people against bad spirits. Therefore, the shoes were prepared not only to walk in cold places, but also to walk in sacred, special places. As you may know, in most religions, when you go into a sacred place, you have to go barefoot. Actually, the figurines that we find, they're always barefoot. Why? Because they're in sacred places. This thread, yoki, is not part of the structure of the shoe and is not made with human hair. It's just on the surface, and it's mainly an ornament. These are some of the shoes that we found in the offerings made in the mountains. Sandals, Yankee style, and these are a pair of sandals that we found in Argentina, and they are a mixture between camelid hair or wool and human hair. And then these other shoes that are like moccasins, polka, that were used by the children that were sacrificed, offered to the gods. We see the kid there, and also a girl that is wearing this type of shoe. They don't show any evidence that they've been worn before, therefore they were used only for the ceremony. These are the shoes that were best preserved. These shoes have the heels worn out. They were different shoes. Probably the one that is missing was offered somewhere else or burnt somewhere else. Why? Because it has a very, it's a symbolically charged, basically. Now I will talk about another case where we have objects that offer us information about these pilgrimages and the vertical conquest of the Incas. I'm going to talk about two different cases, the Jujuyaco volcano located between Argentina and Chile, and the other one is the Arrechucha volcano on the other side of Argentina. Here, for us, what was striking was the way these children died. Not all the times are placid deaths. Like Chronic said, they were given chicha or maize alcohol and they let them die. They would bury them alive so that they would wake up in the other life to become deities. That's what the Chronic said. But we also read that there were strangling and stabbing, among other suffocation, among other types of deaths. And we need to understand that what happened with these deaths. In the case of the girl of the Jujuyaco, the body seems to show what the chronics were saying about a placid death. It seemed like she died in her sleep. However, the girl of the Chucha shows a lot of tension. She has the wound of a knife of at least 15 centimeters depth. At least 15 centimeters deep. Basically, the knife was inserted for at least 15 minutes and she bled out. She died with a lot of pain. And that is reflected in her face. Then we see associated populations. In the case of the Jujuyaco volcano, we don't see any important populations associated with them. In the case of the Chuncha, yes, the girl is part of a population and is from an area where there were many different tribes. There were shepherds, we have the Oasis too, much farther from the area, but they're like Apus. And they were in the foothills of the mountain of the Chuscha. We find corn, potato, and crops of all sorts. In terms of the funeral, in the Chuscha case, we don't know much because the tomb was profanated. The tomb was stolen, was raided. And we could know, therefore, we have information about the archaeological objects and the offerings and so on and so forth. Something else that called our attention, the uncus. This type of dress is mainly masculine. However, it is part of the feminine objects that we found in the funeral objects. And it's on the left shoulder of the girl. But what are these masculine garments telling us in a feminine context? Well, there are different studies that are being carried out, and we know so far that, for example, this uncu here means partnership, alliance. And this other unku means conquest, war. Inca warriors were the ones that used this type of unku, the generals of the army. Therefore, here we see information that we can interpret. We're talking about a productive area. This is one of the areas that was the hardest to conquest by the Incas. and possibly the Qhapaqocha, in other words, the offering sites, were used to seal pacts, in other words, to start a new cycle. So on the one hand, we're going to have the conquest, and therefore a bloody pact or alliance, and that's how we seal the pact after the war. And where does the offering go in a unku linked to war? But through placid death. Therefore, the objects are talking to us about these spaces and what happened. In the case of the Yuyayaco, there are no fortresses, but in this case, all these are fortresses, Inca fortresses. Therefore, we see the most fertile, populated, and conflicted strip is exactly where these findings were. And then also through the same research, we know that the Unku was related to Huaynacapa, and the Inca Unku has to do with Tunka Unka Yupanqui. These are two different times in history, two different Inca actors that had their different roles played in this conquest. Another element that makes us think differently from what Reinhardt was saying, that these burial ceremonies took place simultaneously. No, we think they took places at different times through a pilgrimage. In the architecture, we see that there are walls that were added later on. There are three different techniques used. There are elements that are talking to us about an architect, a type of architecture that was used inside, that was frequently visited. And on the other hand, if we analyze the verticality and the offerings, we'll see that the girl has an initial offering and nothing else. Then the other girl has initial offering and three different groups of offerings. And then the boy that we will talk about now has an initial offering and then five different types of offerings located in different places. Therefore, all this is telling us that this boy was sacrificed, and in other years, other offerings were made to this boy. Therefore, we can establish a timeline. The kid was sacrificed, the first one, then the other girl, and then the third girl. And then the figurines, the objects that we found, they are showing us things. They are loaded with information, encrypted information, embroidered information, and they don't have many different elements, but all of them represent the Tawantinsuyu. They're made of gold, silver, and muyu, which is a shell of Cali and Ecuador. The feathers are from the Amazon, sometimes from coastal areas. The fabric is a very fine fabric made with vicuña or alpaca wool, also comes from specific areas. The gold, the silver come also from specific areas. Dr. Matos was talking about this yesterday. Each suyu was characterized by raw material, and we see all this in the figurines. We see the Tawantinsuyu represented in these figurines. Different artisans represented Cusco in these figurines, and they were taken to their final destination. These figurines are very similar to each other, but we can't find two that are the same. Therefore, there's a whole different series of combinations of textiles, of drawings or carvings, of embroidered fabric. Some of them are laminated, They have different feathers. Therefore, there is a language represented there. And we are trying to understand it. We're doing research to try to decipher it. Mountains and their offerings. They are sacred places where ancestors live and the spirits that rule the spiritual world. These are forbidden places for humans. Imagine the Inca conquest when they went to those places. The mountains were already sacred places, but human beings could not be there because they were the house of the spirits of the deities. And the Incas, when they arrived, they presented themselves as deities, and they went to those places. And against all odds, they managed to get all the way to the summit and then come back. And they kept on doing that, making offers. Therefore, the people that were living there thought they must be deities because they can access those places, and only gods can access those places. These objects also tell us about how these kids died. And part of that information is still unknown to us. We still don't understand everything, the way they died. Also, there's information in their garments, in the height of where they were found. We can't understand what was happening in the summit without understanding what was happening on the foothills. Incas, contrary to what is thought, didn't do everything. They managed everything that existed already. Local populations also have to be understood and studied. Architecture, what we find is a lot of diversity. Each place has different characteristics, different elements. Even though there are common elements too, there is a great deal of diversity. So, this is the type of language that we are trying to understand through the figurines. In the case of Yuyayaco, there is a golden figurine, and gold had to do with masculine things, with corn, maize, with the sun. Then has the alliance sunku. We have another golden figurine. One is laminated, the other one is melted. Why? Are they different? I think there is even a chronological difference between those two. This one has an unku that has to do with war. Maybe even the way these figurines were placed would allow us to see which one comes first, second, and third. Explaining maybe first, alliance comes first, then the conquest, the war, and so on and so forth. The Muyu is the representative of the Mamacocha, fertility, water. Therefore, they're also talking about fertility, about water. If there was an alliance maybe over water, or maybe war over water, all these elements are talking to us. They're loaded with information. The shoes, the way they were placed, the way they were located. Therefore, we have to go beyond our own expertise and actually look at these in a much more holistic manner in order to understand these spaces that are talking to us, actually, even though we cannot hear them. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Very clear, comprehensive, and yet respectful approach to what can be a difficult topic.